Last time we started with general introduction, I qualitatively described to you what is the meaning of stir tank, what are the strengths, what are the weaknesses, what are the principal components of stir tank, and how the different impellers look like, how they are classified. And I mentioned to you the classification on the basis of three criteria. One is close clearance versus open impellers. The second criteria is on the basis of flow generated by the impeller. That is radial flow impellers, axial flow impellers, and tangential flow impellers. The third classification, which I will mention it to you today, but towards the end of the lecture, I wrote one equation which we split into two parts, NQ by NP, NQ into ND cube, into NP by NQ, rho N square D square. And this part we said is equal to flow, and this is turbulence. Here, N is impeller speed, D is diameter, and density is the density of fluid. So all these are, density is, of course, physical property, and impeller speed is measurable, impeller diameter is measurable. What remains is NQ and NP, these are empirical. Maybe I will answer your question in greater detail. What is done in practice is, now we know what is the meaning of stir tank, and take any one impeller. Let us take any one impeller. Give me one impeller. I showed you a lot of impellers last time. Give me a smaller one. Achha, anyway, if you are coming, then you will show, no? Come, come, come. So this straight blade turbine I must have shown you, correct? Now it has certain diameter, maybe approximately 15 centimeters. So we put it in the tank and measure power consumption. There are various ways of measuring power consumption. The most popular is the shaft which conveys power from the motor to the impeller. When impeller is rotating, the shaft is under strain. And there is an equipment measurement technique called strain gauge. and the strain gauge measures the power consumption. So for a given impeller design, yeah. So power imparted to the fluid. Good that you are asking, and I'm going to answer all the questions. Yeah. And in one good part is both the questions are related to each other internally. And that internal relationship also I'll explain to you. In between, if anybody else gets any other question, make it sure that I'll make it sure that I answer all of them. So to begin with, take one impeller design. So we have decided to take, say, straight blade. Our initial question was, is power number empirical? I said empirical. That was anyway, that was a correct answer. And for the question, it was an adequate answer. But I need to explain in greater detail. We want to know the characteristics of power consumption with respect to impeller diameter, impeller speed, liquid density, perhaps liquid viscosity also. So what is done is, we take a tank. So we take a tank of, say, 50 centimeter diameter, in which we put this impeller and begin. The speed is 0.5 revolutions per second, or 30 RPM, and we measure the power. Now the power transmitted by the shaft is delivered to the impeller, and while impeller is rotating, it generates flow. Try to understand. I'm giving a bigger answer, but I'll make it sure that I'll keep it simple. The flow generated, are you able to read this backside? Yeah. This is a straight blade turbine, and if we make velocity measurement at any point, suppose we take a decision that we are going to investigate large number of impellers, and while we are comparing all the impellers, let us fix one point for comparison, and that point can be anyone. So suppose I take this point. And plot velocity versus time. I hope you will be able to see. Velocity versus time. So the flow generated, it has a mean component and it has a fluctuating component. The velocity, since it is turbulent, so at any point in time, there is a mean velocity. So this actual V is V average plus V prime. Have you understood this part? The velocity is not stationary. If the flow was completely laminar, then it would have only mean velocity component. But when the flow is turbulent, it has the mean component plus it has fluctuating component. So the mean velocity square upon 2, V bar square upon 2, is power consumption per unit mass because of mean flow. And V prime square upon 2 is the power consumption which is spent in creating turbulence, that is fluctuating velocities. So the impeller creates flows which has a mean component, which has fluctuating component, or in other words, the flow has mean kinetic energy, V bar square upon 2, and it has turbulent kinetic energy, V prime square upon 2. So the energy which is given by the impeller to the fluid is used by the fluid by creating mean flow and turbulent flow. So motor gives power to the shaft through gearbox. The shaft transmits that power to the impeller. Because of that, impeller rotates, and that power is eventually given to the fluid, and fluid receives the power and generates the flow, which can be mean plus turbulent. Mean component is always there, and the extent of turbulence, the fluctuating part, depends upon what is the Reynolds number and what is actually the impeller, right? Now suppose I have written here, it is a flow component plus turbulent component. Instead of straight blade turbine, I take hydrofoil, which I showed you last time. So for same power consumption, the hydrofoil generates more flow and less of turbulence. Right. So if this is drawn for disk turbine, a straight blade turbine, for hydrofoil, it will generate mean flow, and the fluctuations, the extent of fluctuations are very small. And this is at same power consumption. Maybe we can have a small exercise. Say d cube is 0.1 and rho is 1000. Then we take different values of NP and let power consumption be 2000. That is watts. So NP and N. So if NP is 5 and the straight blade turbine which I showed you, NP is 5, the overall equation is known. So put power consumption 2000 is equal to NP 5, rho 1000, n cube into d raised to 5, which is 0.1, and impeller speed is unknown. So tell me that impeller speed.
D raised to 5.
Always the our original equation is P is equal to NP rho N cube D raised to 5. So did I write D raised to 3? So this is D raised to 5. Sorry. And this is revolutions per second. Instead of 5, suppose we take 3. Take 1. 2.7. And maybe take 0.5, 3.42. And finally 0.2, 4.6. So what I'm trying to tell you, that the velocity versus time has been plotted for two impellers, one having higher power number, and higher power number, these are the impellers which are supposed to create more turbulence and less of mean flow, whereas wherever there are low power numbers, they create more mean flow and less of turbulence. So if we take these two impellers for which the velocity versus time has been plotted, we have seen that the power consumption in both the cases is identical. So for this exactly the same power consumption, one generates more flow and one generates more turbulence. Correct? So what is done in the laboratory is, for a given impeller, we take a tank, measure power consumption, measure speed. Of course, density can also be measured. And on the basis of measured power consumption, impeller speed, density, and d raised to 5, NP is calculated.
Correct.
And whatever NP we get, we do a lot of experiments. For a given design, what we can do, suppose we take 0.5 meter diameter and take impeller diameter is equal to 0.8, 0.1, 0.12, 0.13, 0.2, right? Then take 1 meter diameter and select various impeller diameters, select various viscosities, select various densities, and do maybe 500 experiments, 1,000 experiments. And typically, in chemical engineering departments of different universities, these experiments are done over a wide range of liquid viscosity, liquid density, impeller diameter, the blade width, the tank diameter. And eventually, all those data, remember this, you must have taken this down. I'm going to come back to this table again. And Reynolds number is equal to, which you know, is N d square rho upon mu. It is diameter into velocity, so tip velocity is nd, so nd square rho upon mu. So for every experiment, Reynolds number is calculated, power consumption is measured, and from that np is evaluated, and that np is plotted versus Reynolds number, correct? And do that experiment, but eventually we get a plot of NP versus Reynolds number for a given impeller, which varies with Reynolds number, and the overall behavior is as shown on the board. If we take some other, the impeller which I showed you just now, this gives, so 10 raised to 4 onwards for stirred tank is turbulent regime. Beyond this is turbulent. Below 100 is laminar. And this is transition. So beyond 10 raised to 4, for all the impellers, the value of NP remains constant. And for the impeller which I showed you, that value is 5. But as we go towards laminar, the power number keeps on increasing. If you take hydrofoil, say for example, some other impeller having power number of 0.2, then NP is 0.2 at the highest Reynolds, 10 raised to 4 onwards, and then it will behave something like this. Yeah. For the experiment. Now let us see what are the variables. All right. Liquid viscosity, liquid density, impeller diameter, impeller speed. Correct? So the diameter, speed, density, and viscosity gives a Reynolds number. All right. Power is measured. Power upon rho n cubed d raised to 5 is power number. All right. So nothing is kept constant. Do experiments over a wide range of viscosity, over a wide range of density, over a wide range of impeller speeds, over a wide range of impeller diameter, over a wide range of tank diameters. Keep on measuring power number, estimate power number, and plot it versus Reynolds number. So there is nothing like parameter here now. This is a generalized graph for one impeller design. You do this experiment in Mumbai, London, Los Angeles, or somewhere in Australia. You will get exactly the same curve. Correct? What is empirical about it? That is, the power number, it has not come out from the flow that is generated the way in which I have explained to you up till now. It has come from experiments. Whatever comes from the experiments and finally a correlation is given, it is called empirical correlation, and the methodology is empirical. If the energy released is in the form of turbulence and laminar, and we are able to solve the equations of continuity and motion for stirred tank, and flow generated by the impeller can be predicted, and the extent of turbulence and extent of mean flow can be predicted. The energy associated with turbulence and mean flow can be predicted, can be calculated from solution of the governing equations, and whatever power comes out of that, that will be the method from first principles. Understood? But the method which is being used up till now, the latter method, the attempts are being made over the past not more than 17 years, and our laboratory is also participating in understanding the flows and developing relationships between quality of flow and the performance of stirred tanks, say for heat transfer or gas dispersion or solid suspension. If certain quality of flow is generated, then whether it is good for heat transfer, good for mixing, good for liquid-liquid dispersion. So these are the applications and then the quality of flow. The main point is, if we get fluid flow from first principles, that is by solution of, you must have, of course, derived equations of continuity and motion. If those are solved for this geometry and we get turbulence and mean, then that will be the basic methodology to calculate the power number. With the current status of knowledge, it cannot be done. It cannot be done, all right? So the answer to your basic question is, the approach is indeed empirical. When I say it cannot be done, we have progressed, but that particular part, maybe I will answer separately. There will be a big answer before that. How flows are created, how, what are the methods of the solution, and what has been the chronological development in terms of solving this problem, what are the strengths and limitations of each method, and what is the current practice which does not make any assumption for the estimation of flows. So right from the beginning, what the development has occurred, so that I would have typically explained nicely if I would have taught a subject called computational fluid dynamics, right? So, as far as this class is concerned, this subject is concerned, and teaching you is concerned, the NP versus Reynolds number, this relationship is obtained completely empirically, right? And represented, the performance of the impeller is represented, as far as power consumption is concerned, in the form of NP versus Reynolds number plot. So if I, perhaps I showed you last time 15, 20 impellers, right? Say four, five radial flow impellers, there was a disc turbine, there was a straight blade turbine, then the straight blade was converted into half circle, then it was a parabola, then curved blade turbine, and then the radial propeller. In axial flow impellers, it was a plish blade turbine where number of blades, the blade width, the blade angle, it was varying, and there were plenty impellers. I showed you propeller, I showed you hydrofoil. So for all these impellers, there will be graphs like this. I have drawn two, I can draw 20. But in all those cases, power number is decided by doing experiments, and NP versus Reynolds number is plotted. Correct. What I'm going to do maybe next 15, 20 minutes, for such four or five impellers, and later on, I'm going to add all the impellers which have been reported in the literature, you give the values of impeller diameter, impeller speed, density and viscosity, you will get power, right? So what is done, there is a code which is developed, which incorporates all this information which is already experimentally measured. And for all those impellers, it is stored inside. I'm going to teach you later on, the power consumption is the simplest parameter of the stirred tank. We need to go to heat transfer coefficient or critical impeller speed for solid suspension or gas dispersion. So what is the meaning of that and how to calculate? So a computer code has been developed, and how to use that, that I'm going to teach you. So today we will begin with only power consumption and maybe only three or four impellers. Couple of closed clearance impellers, couple of open impellers, right? And then I'll give you a home assignment that individually you should select some combinations and calculate power consumption. So you prepare a sort of Excel sheet, but write it on your loose paper, that is, start with impeller diameter, then impeller speed, the liquid viscosity, liquid density, all right? And then use the computer code and find out power consumption. But be clear that there is nothing great in the computer code. Whatever experimental data are there, all those experimental data have been collected and they are put together in the computer code. Why in the computer code? There are, since large number of impellers are there, and there is a possibility that we can use any one of these Reynolds numbers in practice, therefore the computer code. Otherwise, there is no necessity. It is very difficult to get this power number versus Reynolds number plot in any one book. If you take mixing book, then maybe 6-7 impellers are given. In another book, some other impellers are given. In some publication, another impeller is given. So the utility of this computer code is all those impellers, the information is collected and put it together. All right. So let me explain to you now how to use that code. Today we are beginning, but as we go further, as I mentioned to you, we'll go to more and more important parameters. Yeah.
So does the behavior
Whatever you have said, I will just complete the description. Here there are number of blades. And straight blade turbine means angle is 90 degrees to the hub. And now there is only blade height. Correct? So the power number versus Reynolds number, that graph will remain identical. The impeller, the blade width versus impeller diameter, that we keep constant, and number of blades we keep constant. Then, if you increase it, then there will be appropriate Reynolds number. At that Reynolds number, you try to read power number, it will be identical. So NP versus Reynolds number is a generalized graph for a given impeller design. If you make two blades instead of six blades, then that is another impeller, and there will be another graph. If you change the angle, change the width, that is another impeller. Right? So for a given impeller, it is independent of diameter, independent of speed, independent of liquid viscosity, and independent of liquid density. Okay? Yeah. So I think you have been given some password and have you been given? So he will tell you how to use it. I had requested you to bring laptops, but your opinion appears to be that you can manage with your cell phones. Are some of you are having laptops? Raise your hands. Very good, very good. I'm very happy. I'm anyway very happy with your class. So have you been logged? So there is one cell phone. Now this I cannot believe, that only one is having a cell phone. This I cannot believe. I'm aware that everybody is having two cell phones or three cell phones. That is possible. No? Now two SIMs are possible. Not two SIMs, two SIMs are possible. Or even three SIMs? What? Array, let us not take a long time. It's very simple. Have you logged in? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, next step.
From start, there are two options. One is global column and save stir tank.
I did not teach to this class other reactors. This I am teaching to third year, but don't worry about it. We are learning only stir tanks. So go to stir tanks. So up till now, it is a single phase, the liquid. Two phase, that is gas liquid, liquid liquid, and solid liquid, I'm going to teach today. But right now, what you are going to do is power consumption for three or four impellers only in liquid. Okay, next. Close clearance impellers and open clearance.
Close clearance on
it. Select close clearance.
And in close clearance you can see there are.
Are you with? So where you are stuck? Array, you take those who have understood, they can take a round. Chaitanya, you can go to this row. Huh? Are nobody is asking questions? Did you get it?
Yes.
So you have opened close clearance?
Yes.
Everybody has opened close clearance, yes?
Yes,
yes, yeah. Okay, what is the next step? So within close clearance, there are two impellers, I think.
In close clearance, there are four impellers that you can see. One is anchor impeller, helical impeller, double helical impeller, and paddle impeller.
P- paddle impeller, did I show you last time?
Just a paddle. So how is it closed?
The impeller diameter is practically same as vessel diameter. Clearance is small, therefore close clearance. Take helical ribbon, all of you.
There are inputs for this impeller. You have to put the input data and you will get the power output.
Let us go stepwise. What is the first one? Impeller diameter? Put diameter. So whatever comes to your mind, put diameter.
Is it meter?
Dimensions you should keep. Are Chaitanya, you be in this row? Put any 0.9, 1 meter, 1.5 meters, 0.5 meters. Write your height individually. That is your impeller diameter. So you're given? Impeller diameter you're given? Okay. What is the next one?
Liquid height.
So liquid height you should give, which is much more than the vessel diameter. It can be equivalent to vessel diameter. It can be little less, but it should be much more than impeller diameter. Okay, next. Impeller diameter. Which impeller we have selected? Close clearance, and vessel diameter is 0.5. So impeller diameter, it should be really close clearance. Say 0.47, 0.48. Yeah. There is nothing like number of blades for helical ribbon. What is the blade width we give helical ribbon? So whatever impeller diameter you have taken, 0.1 times impeller diameter is blade width. So if you have given impeller diameter 0.48, give 0.048. Okay? Next. Next is density, directly Reynolds number, yeah. Give Reynolds number. Give any Reynolds number. You can give below 100, between 100 and 10,000, about 10,000, anyone you can give. Give Reynolds number. Then
viscosity of
Give density? 1000. Give 1000. Viscosity?
0.001.
Give 0.001. Yeah. Give those values. What is next?
After the inputs are complete, click on the compute. Then you will get the power number displayed on the screen.
So helical ribbon, if it is single helical ribbon, it is only one blade.
Okay.
Yeah. So what is the... So have you put in everybody all the data?
Yes.
Have you pressed compute?
Yes, sir.
Are you getting some answer?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Now what I'm suggesting you, I'm going to tell you later on the actual process design I'm going to teach you. Those who are from final year, I took two classes last year, right? So I'm going to take two more classes, further classes, after those two classes, in terms of actually designing the stir tank that I'm going to teach you. For that purpose, these design parameters like power consumption, heat transfer coefficient, interfacial area, mass transfer coefficient, all these parameters are required while designing. So in design, where do they come? That I'll describe to you in very much great detail. But how to estimate that, all that estimation procedure that I'm right now explaining you through the software.
Right.
And today we have begun with the simplest one, that is power consumption. Now as you see, there are only right now some 5, 6, 7 impellers, some 3, 4 open impellers, 3, 4 closed impellers. In very short time, we will put practically all the impellers, so that you should be able to, for a given impeller design, you should be able to compute the power consumption, right? Okay. Have you understood, everybody, the software? So that stage-wise, suppose we are meeting 4 times, 5 times, we will take one more difficult design objective and compute. Okay.
Huh. Inverted bucket type impeller is in which category?
Now, how much is impeller diameter? How much is vessel diameter?
Say open.
Open. Very simple. Huh? So, anything else, Parikshit, we want to explain? That's it as far as today is concerned?
Yes. And yeah. If you want to see your historical calculations, past calculations, then there is one option at the top. You can go here, computer results. There you will see your previous calculations. If you want to refer what you calculate.
So take one home assignment. You are free to take any combination, but whatever impellers are listed here for every impeller, take one impeller diameter, take density, take viscosity, take Reynolds number, and calculate power consumption, right? So each one will submit next time a paper, one full-scale paper, in which there will be four combinations and answer will be power consumption. This is just for practice, for practice purpose. Have you understood the home assignment?
Yes, sir.
The backside is not attending to me. Is there any other lecture going on the backside? Have you understood backside?
Yes, sir.
What is that you have understood? Home assignment. What is the home assignment? Very good, very good. So there are impellers which are there on the software just now. Take all of them. For each one, you are free to take any viscosity, any density, any Reynolds number. You can give a Reynolds number of one. All of them have been fitted. I have mentioned to you very clearly that in the whenever it was empirically measured, that one Reynolds number must be the experimental Reynolds number. For which that number was there, that number has been stored in the computer and it calculates. Okay? It is as simple as that. Okay. So let us go further. So the equation which I wrote at the end of last lecture, I wanted to explain in greater detail. So I showed you earlier, there are some impellers which create more flow as compared to turbulence, and there are some impellers where the turbulent kinetic energy is substantial. So the classification is like this. The flow generating impellers So maybe we can start with gate, helical ribbon, then anchor, propeller, hydrofoil, pitch blade turbine, then say disk turbine, and after disk turbine there is one impeller called homogenizer. When the viscosity is very, very high, like the creams and pastes and paints, so in that case, the power consumption required is very large, maybe up the order of 1,000 kilowatts per meter cube. So it is a close clearance impeller. The quantity of paste to be handled is very small as compared to the mixing vessel volume, maybe 5%, 10%. And 95% volume is impeller itself, and it creates a lot of volume, a lot of power consumption for given volume. And that is a turbulence creating impeller. For a disk turbine, I showed you a half circle, and the name was CD6, and there was a gas foil. So if I plot, and we need to plot flow versus turbulence for same power consumption. So if you take gate, or if you take propeller, and the graph which I had drawn earlier, so for straight blade turbine, for the same power consumption, the mean will be here. Then if you take, say, a pitch blade turbine, then the mean is here. And then you take some hydrofoil, then mean is here for the same power consumption. But here the level of turbulence is very high. As compared to that, here level of turbulence is less. But turbulent energy and mean energy put together in all the cases is exactly identical, which we have taken is equal to 2000. Here it is. The turbulence is meager as compared to the mean flow. So this is the classification. If you take homogenizer or disk turbine, whatever flow is generated, 80%, 85% component of the flow is turbulent kinetic energy, and 15%, 10% is mean kinetic energy. Whereas if you take helical ribbon, 80% is with mean flow, and 10 to 15 up to 20% is turbulent kinetic energy. Understood? So this is the third classification. The first one was closed clearance versus open impellers. Second one was radial, axial, tangential flow impellers. And the third classification is flow generating impellers versus the turbulence generating impellers. I described to you in greater detail because there are about 5-6 applications, or maximum 7 major applications for which we use stirred tanks, right? The first one is mixing and blending. There may be 2 miscible liquids, but we want to really mix them, blend them together. This is first application. Second one is heat transfer. The third one is solid liquid dispersion. Fourth one is gas liquid dispersion. Fifth one is gas liquid solid dispersion. And then perhaps gas liquid liquid solid dispersion. So these are the different applications. And for these applications, for first 3 applications, be attentive now if you were not. The flow generating impellers are typically used for mixing and blending, heat transfer, and solid dispersion, solid suspension, and solid dispersion. These are the 3 applications for which, let me write it. I'm giving you a thumb rule on the basis of my experience. If mixing and blending is the application, the power consumption in terms of kilowatts per meter cube of contents in the tank, this is 0.1 to 1. Heat transfer 0.2 to 1.2. Solid suspension 0.5 to 1.5. Gas liquid dispersion about 2 to 10. Liquid-liquid dispersion, about 2 to 15. Gas-liquid-solid dispersion, 2 to 10. This is the range. Now, for example, say gas-liquid dispersion, I have given you a thumb rule that it is in the range of 2 to 10. So whether it should be 2, 3, 5, or 10, correct, no? This is a very wide range which is given. Where is the thumb rule there? Correct, no? If such a wide range is given, then... So whatever I'm going to tell you the next in 5 minutes is very, very important. I think I must have done it last time, but listen carefully. Gas liquid dispersion, gas is introduced at the bottom, and impeller does the job of breaking the inlet gas into bubbles and distributing the bubbles throughout the liquid. That is the job of impeller. As we increase the power consumption, the bubbles are broken to smaller and smaller sizes, and they are retained into the stirred vessel for longer time. In other words, the gas fraction increases with increasing impeller speed. All right. Because of that, the gas holdup, the interfacial area, mass transfer coefficient, heat transfer coefficient, all of them increase with power consumption. All right. Now, if there is any objective, suppose we are designing stirred tank for catalytic hydrogenation. Hydrogen is dissolved first, and then it reacts.
Correct.
And rate of dissolution depends upon mass transfer coefficient. So mass transfer coefficient will decide what is the volumetric rate of reaction. This I taught you last year. That is, we do experiments in the laboratory, try to find the unknown system in which regime it falls, and finally calculate the rate in terms of kilomole per meter cube second. Do you remember last year's lectures? We use model contactor, and then for gas liquid, how to do that? Which one is called very slow and fast and instantaneous? How to find that, how to bring it into the first regime or third regime and get the kinetics, correct? So we know kilomoles per meter cube second, and we know the capacity, right? Suppose we want to manufacture 100 kilomoles per hour. So 100 kilomoles per hour, from which we can calculate kilomoles per second, divided by kilomoles per meter cube second, gives the total volume of the stirred tank. I'm telling you orally the design procedure. All right. I'm going to derive in great detail when I teach you the process design, but this is very simple. The experiments in the laboratory tell us kilomoles per meter cube second. The overall capacity, manufacturing capacity, is known in terms of kilomoles per second, and that gives the overall volume of stirred tank, right? Now, as you increase power consumption, the denominator increases and volume of the tank goes down. So for one power consumption, say 2 kilowatt per meter cube, the stirred tank volume is 20 meter cube. Whereas at 10 kilowatts per meter cube, the stirred tank volume is say 3 meter cube. Then what do? For 20 meter cube, we go to the fabricator. What is the price of 20 meter cube? 1 lakh rupees, say 100 lakh rupees, 1 crore of rupees. And for 3 meter cube, what is the price? Say 20 lakh rupees. So we are consuming power at 10 rupees per kilowatt hour. And when it is 10 kilowatt per meter cube and volume is 3 meter cube, so 10 into 3, and we operate the equipment in chemical industry for 8,000 hours. So 10 kilowatts per meter cube into 3 meter cube into 8,000 into 10 rupees. Is that 24 lakhs or 24 crores? 24 lakhs. So that is when the volume is 3 meter cube and power consumption is 10. That instead, we take the other option, 2 kilowatt per ton, but volume is 20 meter cube. So 2 into 20 into 8,000 into 10. Again, 32 lakhs, correct? But the 20 meter cube costed 1 crore and 3 meter cube costed 20 lakhs. So the decision is straightforward. So the rule of thumb is given in this form. For given material of construction, we really calculate the tank volume in every case and compare. Now, since you are in fourth year, I assume that chemical engineering economics, that course is done. And you know the meaning of depreciation, you know the meaning of interest. In no business, self money is used. We always take money from bank. All right? And bank charges in the form of interest, and depreciation is every year what is in the reduction in the value. So we find out annualized cost of operating plus the capitalized cost of the equipment and find the total cost. So when the range is given 2 to 10, we calculate for every power consumption what will be the equipment volume and what will be the power consumption, and finally come to the results. This is the real answer. But when we know nothing, did I use these words last time? Now I think these are very good words. Whenever we start learning any subject, we should start assuming that we know nothing. And now an unknown gas liquid system is given to us. And for that unknown gas liquid system, how to get kinetics that I taught you last year? And how to get mass transfer coefficient, heat transfer coefficient, and interfacial area that I'm going to teach this time. Right. And knowing these values, how to get the tank volume, that also I'm going to teach this year. Having obtained the volume and the dimensions, get the price, get capital cost, get operating cost, and from that, get the overall decision. So from the point of we know nothing, we come to the stage that we know almost everything. That is, let there be any level of power consumption, let there be any partial pressure, let there be any temperature, let there be any operating pressure. For all those cases, I'm able to tell what is the fixed cost and how much is operating cost, right? So then After having these combinations, obviously one result can be wherever is the minimum, we take that combination. Right? But in reality, I'm telling you two realities, and there can be many realities. Suppose you are putting your own business, right, as a startup, and you have one good idea of producing something which is of high value, and you purchase a place in some industrial area. Now, in that industrial area, you are allocated certain power consumption. That is, in your factory, you shall use only 100 kilowatts. Right. Now you have stir tanks, you have centrifuge, you have pumps, you have many equipment. But all put together has to be 100 kilowatt. Then the decision is different. All right. It is likely that spending more money at time t is equal to zero is more economical as compared to operating cost. Right? Let me spend 1 crore today, but later on, the power consumption is less, and the overall optimum is the large capital cost and low operating cost. But it is likely that whenever we start the business, we don't have money. So that optimum of high capital cost, then we don't select. We spend money only whatever we have, right? So there are several constraints, and as an engineer, we need to honor whatever are the... Constraint is not a word which I like. It is a reality. I think let us call it as a reality. So depending upon the reality, for that reality, then we try to optimize for everywhere. So the range of 2 to 10, there are two considerations I explained to you. The most important is financial calculation and what is the attractive number, overall attractive number. And then later on, we try to honor whatever are the realities. And on the basis of reality, we take the final decision, right? But this part of process design and how to get these parameters, this I'm going to teach anyway. I will now cover a very small portion, and then we will take a break. We'll take a break at 5 o'clock, and we have 7 minutes. We have seen power consumption whenever only liquid is present, and you have calculated power consumption when NP versus RE data is embedded somewhere else. Using that, you know now how to calculate power consumption, correct? That was how the power number versus Reynolds number will take shape when it is solid liquid dispersion that I'm going to explain to you. I want your cooperation of all of you, since I'm having plenty assignments, and whatever I want to teach you, that part I'm not going to reduce. I'm going to teach, which I have already announced. I'm going to teach you process design. I'm going to teach you how to get these design parameters and how to carry out optimization. General methodology I told you just now, but I'll give you some home assignments by which you will get experience, all right? The cooperation I want is, I need to travel. There are several central government committees and state government committees, and I'm very busy in taking science to society, developing technologies for common people, etc. The sum and substance is, I may call you more number of times in a week, right? And then there may be one free week, and again 2-3 times in another week, and so on. That is the only cooperation I want from you. Okay. You are in final year, no? So you will also have periodic test. Only master's students, they will not have periodic test. Okay. So the solid suspension, whenever we put solids and impeller speed is zero, these are in settled condition. If it is, say, downflow impeller, and we start the impeller, this is a downflow impeller. So the flow generated by the impeller hits the bottom, and all the solids, they get collected in the corner. And when it is a flow impeller, the solids get collected below the impeller, and this is called cone, and this is called fillet. Solids get accumulated. You can visualize. Correct? Now, since 3 minutes are remaining, I will explain orally now. When we increase the speed further, the liquid velocities, either mean or fluctuating, or both, they try to become comparable to the solid settling velocity. So particles start vibrating at their own location. They become loose from each other, right? And they again spread on the bottom. And all of them are under motion. All of them are under motion. Practically none of them, if at all they become stationary, they remain stationary maybe for 1 or 2 seconds, not more than that. And again they are on motion, but all the particles on the bottom. So when this condition is reached, we call it, that is the impeller speed, which is referred to as on bottom suspension. I explain again, all the particles are in motion. If at all they are stationary on the bottom, they are not more than 1 or 2 seconds, but all of them are on the bottom. If we increase the speed further, the particles come into liquid upwards, they get suspended, and they go to the bottom also. So this is the case where all the particles are in suspended conditions. Some of them can go to the bottom, but they cannot stay on the bottom for more than 1 or 2 seconds. This is called off-bottom suspension. The first one was on-bottom suspension. The second was off-bottom suspension. But still, those all the particles are in suspension. They still occupy only bottom region of the tank. If we increase the speed further, the suspension height, which is at the bottom, keeps on increasing. It can come to the impeller, and depending upon particle size, it can homogenize practically 100%. So it is uniform slurry. If the particles are heavy, then we can suspend them up to certain level. We take a break exactly 5 o'clock. I'll explain all these points: on bottom suspension, off bottom suspension, and suspension further. 50% of the tank is filled with particles. 100% tank is. So particle is available everywhere in the tank. It entirely depends upon impeller speed. So like gas liquid dispersion, is there any thumb rule? How much suspension should occur? Are we happy with on bottom? Are we happy with off bottom? Do we want to suspend them? Do we want to homogenize them completely? I will tell you in about 15 minutes.